So, a very good evening and have a great day ahead. Keith, are the most common diagnostic tools used by the forensic odontologists to complete forensic investigations, that is, to find out the identity of the deceased individual. Sometimes teeth are not present for forensic investigations. In such cases, alveolar bone plays a very important role, and thus, the understanding the role of alveolar bone in forensics using various methods of person identification related to dentistry is my topic of presentation, that is, alveolar bone as a valuable evidence in forensic investigations. It is divided into the introduction, forensic evidences in the literature, forensic methods of person identification using alveolar bone, ticking block picking evidences, recent advances, conclusion, and references. Next slide, please. So what is alveolar bone? As we all are aware that alveolar bone consists of an outer corticular bone filled with spongy bone inside with along with the Heversian canals and trabeculated bone when viewed microscopically. Whereas forensic odontology is analysis of dental evidence. And there are various methods of person identification, that is fingerprint and palm print, lip print and bite marks, footprint and shoe prints, various body fluids, DNA fingerprinting, heart tissue such as bones and teeth, tattoos and body piercing, voice analysis, scar surgeries, marks, deformities, handwriting and signature analysis, facial features and facial reconstruction, gait pattern analysis, hair analysis and image analysis. Forensic evidence of many eminent personalities were identified using alveolar bone, which is presented on the right side, beginning with the first case, which was the first case of a dentist as a professional witness in 1814, held in Scotland, Glasgow. The first dental evidence accepted by the law court, which was the famous USA Parkman's Webster's case in 1849, the identification of Abraham Lincoln's assassin in 1865, the identification of Adolf Hitler in 1945, and the Queen Hatshepsut's mummy mystery of 1458 BC, which was identified in 2007. Next slide, please. Next slide, please.
Morphological methods. Yes, I am on the next slide, that is morphological methods.
And the screen is freezed at my end. Yeah, now it's visible. Okay. So beginning with the different methods of person identification using alveolar bone as an evidence. So the first method is the morphological method, which is the big four of person identification. There are various morphological parameters to identify a forensic specimen, which can be age, sex, race, and stature. So how to identify the age? By the number of whole ostean and ostean fragments, degenerative changes in the skeletal features, eruption and sequence of eruption of teeth, and appearance and fusion of ossification centers of the bones. How to identify the sex? By the comparison of the male and the female skull, where the female skull is smaller and lighter, with rounded forehead, pointed chin, and sloping or obtuse angle of the jaw, while the male skull is larger and heavier, with sloping and less rounded forehead, square chin, and vertical angle of the jaw. The race can be identified by observing the characteristics of the skull, such as nasal openings, zygomatic bones, maxillary bones, and teeth. While the stature is identified by the glabellinian length, maximum biparietal diameter, and auricular head height. Next slide, please. Moving on to the alveolar bone radiographs and identification. The forensic interpretation includes the age estimation and the sex determination, where the age estimation is done by tooth cementum angulation using the atlas and the scoring method, where the sex is determined by assessing the symmetry, morphology, border outline, and presence of septa and cells of the frontal sinus. Next slide, please. Moving on to the third method, which is the histology and forensic diagnosis. So as we have already discussed earlier, that alveolar bone consists of an outer corticular bone filled with spongy bone inside, with trabeculated bone and Heversian canals. The difference in appearance of the bone seen in the different bones of the same skeleton, different parts of the same bone, different areas of the same section, at different species and at different stages, ages, a person can be identified. Also, based on the clinical and anthropological research, it is demonstrated that the bone turnover in cortical bone occurs at a predictable rate over an individual's lifetime. So the length of the time during which the remodeling occurs will be the primary influence on how many secondary osteum creations accumulate per unit area. Next slide, please. The fourth method, which is DNA of alveolar bone, is an anchor for diagnosis. DNA, which persists in bones and teeth much longer than the soft tissues of the body due to its chemically bound hydroxyapatite to the heart tissues, The steps of identification, such as decontamination of DNA, pulverization and subsequent incubation, grinding of sample in bone powder and purification of DNA, nuclear and mitochondrial DNA can be found out, and these can be used in cases of mass disaster and unidentified remain cases. Next slide, please. Next slide.
We are on the slide digital methods of identification. I think due to network issues with
yes.
At your site. Yeah.
So moving on to the fifth method of forensic identification is the digital method of identification, wherein soft copies of radiographs are used for analysis. Next slide, please.
I'm on the next slide.
Ticking clock picking evidences. The duration between the death time and the forensic investigation plays a vital role in addition to the routine parameters. Suppose if the specimen is of 30 month old, there is tunneling within both the internal and external circumferential lamellae, which is recognizable histologically when fungi or bacteria infiltrate the mid zone of substantia compacta is observed. Similarly, if the specimen is of 5 year old, there is loss of immunological activity seen. If the specimen is of 10 year old, there are histological changes which seen as erosive changes, which were identifiable initially within the Havercian canals and the interstitial lamellae. If the specimen is of 15-year-old, there is presence of erosive fungal and bacterial tunnels forming characteristic labyrinth spaces. If the specimen is of 50-year-old, there is loss of nitrogen greater than 3.5% by weight seen. If the specimen is of 100-year-old, then there is greater than less than 7% 7 amino acids from the organic phase of the bone, and the loss of inherent fluorescence pattern of cut bone begins. If the specimen is of 350-year-old, then the loss of nitrogen greater than 2.5% by weight is seen. If the specimen is of 800-year-old, there is a progression of loss of inherent fluorescence pattern of cut bone, and specific loss of proline or hydroxyproline indicates that the bone is ancient. Next slide, please. Recent advances include craniofacial superimposition technique, which is a technique used in the field of forensic anthropology to assess the analysis of an unknown skull. The process involves superimposing an image of a recovered skull over the antemortem image of the suspected individual. The types include photographic craniofacial superimposition technique, video craniofacial superimposition technique, and computer-aided craniofacial superimposition technique. The stages include face enhancement and skull modeling, SFO, which is the skull face overlay, and decision making. Next slide, please. By concluding, I would like to say that alveolar bone plays a very important role in various spectrums of forensic identification, such as radiology, histology, molecular biology, and digital identification technique. By studying these aspects, one can find out the possible diseases incurred by the dead individual and also the cause of death. As it is said that any data without its use to the mankind is just data, and data without application is junk. The application of this data can lead to a foundation of a strong evidence in legal proceedings and also on the humanitarian grounds. Thank you so much, and these are my references on the right side.